Salvatore. I'm going to wind this down a little bit. I realize I've been here for the most of the last couple of days, and we've been listening to a lot of very, very interesting and complicated talks. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands in the way that FK did, but I will be very specific, and I want very specific people to raise their hands if they fit into this criteria. Who presently, in their day job, is generating data to fit a scientific paradigm and the research theory dogma of testing hypotheses and rejecting and accepting them and moving forward and communicating that through research? Who is an active researcher in the way that we define that this day today? We have a handful of researchers, and that's really good to see. I think a few of you that I know didn't put up your hand because you probably don't want me to target you. We're selfish creatures. My background is research. I generated data. I tested hypotheses. I think it was Henry Kissinger that once remarked that researchers and their arguments can be vindictive and vile because the stakes are so low. That is because we're concerned about the way that we provide information and communicate what we believe to be hypotheses for the data that's generated from what we observe in our day-to-day working life. Anything else to a researcher appears to be a burden. That is no different for the way that data is managed. Ordinarily and previously, we were able to manage it in a contained way, in a much more manageable way. That's not the case anymore, and we're annoyed. I keep on saying we're. I haven't been a researcher for quite some time now. But researchers are generally annoyed that they have to endure this added overhead of having to look after the data that they've generated, even beyond what they would ordinarily consider their project or their theory life cycle. So I took quite a different tack when I approached this in the ODE Work Package 4, and this will be a nice big font presentation. Not much there. The people in front might get sunburnt from the yellow color. Harking back to the days when I was a researcher, where most slides would only ever be in blue and yellow, and you had to print them off yourself. We had a look at trying to gather together the five main requirements that researchers have that are actually quite fundamental to the whole preservation, access, open data, open-ish data, not open data, conversations that are going on around the world. So with that in mind, we then had to focus that into the opportunity. This entire project is about opportunities for data exchange. We needed to understand perspectives. FK is talking about publishers. We're going to hear about libraries and data centers after me. I was particularly interested in really trying to drill into the needs and requirements of researchers. I'm not going to go through them here because I want you all to go and read the report, which is available in various different ways. And then from that, to actually say opportunities. Now, this is not opportunities to do new things. It can be. But actually, there's quite a lot going on anyway. And we'll probably reveal a couple of those if you haven't seen them already or if it hasn't been apparent to you, then maybe we can talk about that later. So I say abstract requirements. They're not really abstract requirements. Whenever I talk to researchers at the moment and in previous roles that I've had before the British Library and before the Cancer Research UK, when you talked about data sharing to scientists, if you manage to get over that initial reluctance to say, well, actually, it's my data, I'm data mining, they didn't seem to have too much of a problem. Their first thing was, well, where am I going to put it? I can't look after this. It's a burden. It's an overhead. I can't look after this. However, if it does go somewhere, I still want to have control of it. I want to make sure that I'm giving it to people by consent. I don't know how to do this. This is not new. I don't really get much of an incentive to do that. And we had some great plugs for a service that's dear to my heart right at the moment, DataCite, from Tony and John yesterday, which was great. And then, of course, whenever you're talking about any sort of research activity in pretty much any country, there's going to be overheads and costs that are associated with the infrastructures that enable you to do all of this. So these are the requirements. They're quite simple, really, when you look at them. However, enacting them is always going to be complex. So we came with this idea of a data currency. As data is valuable to some people, it's not so valuable to other people, and actually the value changes. I don't wish to, in such economically uncertain times in the European community, I don't wish to get into too much about this. But, you know, keeping data safe from either misuse or controlling the way that it's happening, being able to use data markets and exploit data markets to the point of being able to make it sustainable and cover these costs for the infrastructures. Is data a currency? I'm not convinced, but it gave us a view to look at the opportunities that might arise. So, opportunity one, availability. Researchers consider their data to be first-class research objects, irrespective of whether anyone else does. The data that I generated, people in my discipline may consider to be rubbish. I consider it to be a first-class research object that I generated as part of my professional research career. But if there's going to be data sharing, if there's going to be opportunities to exchange data, then researchers have to understand how to loosen control over that, and that's happening. Those of you from the UK will, I think, tend to agree with me that we're quite blessed with data centers. They're not comprehensive by any means, but there's a beginning. There are data centers in this country that are specifically funded to look after the data that's generated from your research. But defining the roles and the responsibilities for the people to becoming the custodians of these data are something that is still unclear in my mind, and I think it's quite unclear in a lot of other people's as well. Does the data, if I'm going to loosen control of it, do I become responsible for it? Was I responsible for it in the first place? Actually, if I'm going to have to pay for it, then no, I don't want to be responsible for it, but I want to be able to get credit for it. A few competing interests, a couple of opportunities there. The first one, recognizing it as an object that deserves first-class attention. Opportunity number two, findability. The second question that is answered when I talk about what researchers want when they talk about how their data are shared or used. They want people to be able to find it. They want to be able to find it once they've got it. The concept of persistent identifiers is not new. And I always say, when I talk about persistence identifiers, is there's two problems with persistent identifiers. They're rarely persistent, and it's often ambiguous what they identify. Now, those are not insurmountable problems, and there have been various efforts around the place to have a go at least providing some framework over which that happens. ARCs, DOIs, handles, all sorts of manner of life science IDs. Fundamental to being able to find something is to have a common metadata and practices and conventions around that. Opportunity interoperability. I'm getting into interoperability a bit too much. Interpretability. This harks again to the idea of common or best practices, not necessarily comprehensive best practice either, in the way that data are described, metadata development. Anything you can do, I can do meta. Anyone that's had anything to do with a metadata specification realizes that it can go on for as long as you care it to go on for. I was in a teleconference with a bunch of cancer researchers in the National Institutes of Health in the United States for 2 hours trying to determine how many different sorts of sexes there were in the human species and how to represent that in a metadata specification. Now, if you're going to do that for every single datum point that is captured in medical research, in modern medical research, then frankly, you're trying to climb Everest dressed in shorts. So best practice, start simple. These are opportunities to support different disciplines in the way this happens. Opportunity number five, reusability, preservation. I'm not going to talk too much about this, because most scientists think to preserve their data, they can stick it on their hard drive, and as long as they just keep finding it in their operational upgrades. Most of you know more about this than I do. I think there's still an opportunity there, and I think that's why we're here today. Citability. We heard that DataCite had been mentioned a couple of times, but actually this really starts to dig into providing researchers with an incentive to undertake the burdens and to take on the activities that are required for them to preserve their data, to share their data, to do anything with their data past its original use. There has to be a convention in the same way that there is a convention with referring to publications. There has to be this for data as well. And that's starting to happen. It's happened. You know, there are different ways of doing that. It's not new. This has been around for a little while as well. But in the same way that there's lots of different ways to cite publications, there's probably going to be lots of different ways to cite data as well. I don't think we should stumble too much on that. And as Kevin Ashley once said to me, we should start with the stuff that we understand and worry about the edge cases when we get to them, because you can always be guaranteed that people will bring up the edge cases just to stimulate conversation. Opportunity six, curation, data archives. Most people will have had some sort of interaction with them in this room. Most people in this room will have had some sort of interaction with them. I'm not too sure that the majority of researchers that I've ever encountered have had much to do with them. I think there's certainly an opportunity there for either understanding why that is. For example, if you talk to some people of a particular unnamed data archive in this country, you will hear that most data is rejected because it's rubbish and it's not looked after very well. And it's not being constructed very well, it's not being recorded very well, and it doesn't deserve to be in the data archive. Now, actually, that's quite an important barrier, I think, to put in the way of researchers, because if you're going to provide them with an incentive to do this, you're actually going to get them to want to do more work. And this is a good way for people to see the value in data, in a way that we've not really been able to create a scenario about in such an easy way. Opportunity there for curation. Colleagues of mine at the EBI know all about curation. preservation, this sustainability issue, the sustainability concepts of preservation, not the preservation concepts of preservation. Sustainability is something I know a little bit about with the setting up of the data site service. Stuff costs money. It doesn't cost very much money, but it does cost money. And being open and realistic about how much money it costs is something that needs to occur, whether that's, let me put this straight. Not only does it need to occur, it needs to be explained to researchers clearly, openly. I think most people will admit that being open and honest is a great way to be, just most people don't want to do it because it makes you vulnerable and you can be taken advantage of. I think, actually, we don't have a fully clear understanding of the costs that are involved in the sorts of activities that we want to do, and it would be great to have something like that. So, is data a currency? Well, researchers, I think it is. They see it as a definition of the work that they've done. It's the evidence that sits behind the publications, that's their communication with their colleagues, with the outside world. They hide it away in the way that selfish, greedy people do. I can claim to be part of that as well. But I think there's a change going there. And there are opportunities for people to understand how that can be brought forward. And I think some of those opportunities are more advanced than others. Sometimes that opportunity will be to support researchers in the way that, say, data management plans have been helping researchers in this country and in the UK and the US understand how to make their data more available. The way data archives and data centers in this country have been able to show how their data can be reused, and the way that DataCite has shown, actually, this can begin to be a framework to count towards your professional career. It may end up being that this can supplement the professional impact that your career provides. Now, once you say professional impact, you have most researchers' attention. What we don't want is to get their attention and then lose it again. Thank you very much.
I think we can take one question for Max, if there is any.